Welcome back, everyone. I'm Jordan Giesige, and this is The Limiting Factor. I spent a day reading through and analyzing Tesla's recently published lithium refining patent application so you don't have to. As part of that process, I took the incomplete and illegible drawings from the application, consolidated them, cleaned them up, and filled in the missing pieces to create the flowchart on screen. Most of this flowchart is likely representative of the process that Tesla's using at their lithium refinery in Texas. So today, I'll walk you through Tesla's process to manufacture lithium hydroxide for high nickel lithium ion batteries, the full list of benefits of Tesla's process, and how the same facility could also support the production of low-cost LFP and sodium ion batteries in the future. Before we begin, a special thanks to my Patreon supporters, YouTube members, and Twitter subscribers, as well as RebellionAir.com. They specialize in helping investors manage concentrated positions. RebellionAir can help with covered calls, risk management, and creating a money master plan from your financial first principles. The title of the patent application is Method of Soda Ash Preparation for Lithium Mineral Refining and Compositions Thereof. What's the significance of soda ash, also known as sodium carbonate? Tesla states that lithium-containing minerals such as spodumene can be refined using a sulfuric acid leach process or a soda ash leach process. To understand what they mean by that, let's take a look at this collection of flowcharts from Albemarle, which provides a high-level overview of the concentration and conversion routes used to produce lithium hydroxide from clay, brine, and spodumene. Concentration is the process of taking lithium from around 1% in the natural environment up to around 5-7% so that it can be more easily used in the conversion step, also known as refining. Let's focus on spodumene because that's the material that Tesla's patent application focused on. We can ignore the concentration step because it's done at the mine and produces concentrate that can be used in any of the three major refining routes. Those three routes are sulfuric acid leaching, soda ash leaching, and alkaline leaching. We can ignore alkaline leaching because it wasn't mentioned by the patent, and as of a few years ago, was still considered in the concept phase. Sulfuric acid leaching, on the other hand, is well established in the lithium industry, and is the process by which all other lithium refining processes are judged by. Lastly, soda ash leaching is the refining process that Tesla is using, and up until a few years ago was still considered to be in the pilot phase. Why didn't Tesla just use the industry standard sulfuric acid leaching process? First, because sulfuric acid is much more toxic and reactive than soda ash. That means higher production costs and greater risks for brand damage. Second, because, as we'll see in a moment, Tesla's soda ash process has the potential for lower CO2 emissions, higher end-to-end efficiency, cheaper inputs, built-in recycling loops, and more useful waste products. When I asked Grok to take into account all of those factors and the current market price of spodumene, it estimated that for a U.S. facility, a soda ash process would produce lithium hydroxide for $10,000 per ton, and a sulfuric acid roasting process would produce lithium hydroxide for $12,250 per ton. So, the soda ash process offered about a 20% savings over a sulfuric acid process. That's less than the 33% cost savings Tesla claimed at Battery Day, but I'm inclined to go with the more conservative 20% cost savings figure because we don't know what factors Tesla included in their cost estimate. For example, if they were talking about production cost or market price. Furthermore, Tesla may now be using a different process than they had in mind at Battery Day. More on that in a moment. Either way, thanks to the soda ash process, Tesla now has in-house lithium production that should be fundamentally cheaper, cleaner, and safer than lithium produced using conventional methods. That's not to mention the three major strategic benefits of in-house production. First, it will protect Tesla from the Chinese monopoly on refining, which could be used as leverage against Tesla in the future. Second, it will protect Tesla from regulatory changes meant to penalize China and/or blunt the growth of renewables. Third, it will insulate Tesla from price swings in the lithium market. It was only a few years ago that the contract price of lithium hydroxide skyrocketed to $30,000 per ton, with $10,000 of that cost going to the refiner as profit. That's $10,000 per ton that Tesla could have saved if they would have had in-house lithium refining. Now that we understand the high-level reasons why Tesla's using a soda ash refining process, let's take a look at the detailed flowchart I created from the patent application. Most of the right-hand side of the screen is the process used to manufacture soda ash on-site for lithium refining, and the left-hand side of the screen is the refining process itself. What Tesla's done here is integrated a modified version of the Solvay process into their lithium refinery. With a Solvay process, a brine-containing table salt is aminated, that is, infused with ammonia, and then combined with carbon dioxide from the calcination of limestone. That produces a baking soda and ammonium chloride solution, which is then separated by filtration. The baking soda goes on to produce the primary output, soda ash, and the ammonium chloride is reacted with calcium oxide from the calcination of limestone from the first step to form calcium chloride, which is often used as road salt, and ammonia, which is recycled back to aminate the next batch of brine. Tesla's process also starts with aminating a brine of table salt and water. But instead of using CO2 from limestone, they capture the CO2 from natural gas that's burnt to heat a kiln that calcinates spodumene concentrate. After all of those chemicals react in the carbonation tower, that again produces baking soda and ammonium chloride. After filtering, the baking soda goes on to produce the primary output, soda ash, and the ammonium chloride is heated to produce hydrochloric acid, which can be sold, and ammonia, which is again recycled to aminate the next batch of brine. That is, the inputs of Tesla's on-site soda ash production process are low-cost table salt and water, recovered ammonia, and waste CO2 gas from the calcination kiln. That should make for soda ash that's as cheap or cheaper than they can purchase from any other source on the market due to the fact that they won't have to pay shipping costs, logistics costs, and profit margins to a third-party supplier. Interestingly, the patent application states that the spodumene refining process consumes about 0.2 tons of soda ash per ton of spodumene, but the natural gas burned to calcinate the spodumene creates enough CO2 to manufacture 0.28 tons of soda ash, meaning the process could run a surplus of soda ash. What else can soda ash be used for? Sodium ion batteries, which can use sodium carbonate as feedstock to produce sodium ion based cathodes. It may require some additional refining, but the opportunity is there. Moving along, let's cut over from the on-site soda ash production plant to the lithium refining process itself. As I said a moment ago, natural gas can be used to fire the kiln that roasts or calcinates the spodumene concentrate that's received from mining companies. I think of calcination like popping popcorn. When spodumene is heated to around 1,000 degrees Celsius, the crystal structure changes, creating volume expansion and increased porosity. That allows the lithium trapped in the crystal structure to be extracted more easily in subsequent steps. For reference, the initial spodumene crystal structure is called alpha spodumene, and after calcination, it's called beta spodumene. In Tesla's process, the beta spodumene is then combined with soda ash in a high-temperature leach solution. That causes the lithium in the spodumene to bind with carbonate in the soda ash to form a lithium carbonate solution, and the sodium in the soda ash to enter the crystal structure of the spodumene, which leaves sand as a byproduct. At this point, the lithium refining process would be almost finished if the goal was to create lithium powder for LFP batteries. That's because lithium carbonate is the preferred feedstock to produce LFP cathode material. So besides the target product, lithium hydroxide, there are two chemistry classes that can be supported by Tesla's lithium refining process, sodium ion and LFP. Next, lime is added to the lithium carbonate solution. That causes limestone to precipitate out of the solution and converts the lithium carbonate into lithium hydroxide, which is the feedstock for the high nickel cathode material that Tesla prefers to use in its U.S. vehicle production. Lastly, the lithium hydroxide solution is filtered and dried to become lithium hydroxide powder, which will then likely be shipped to Tesla's cathode production facility at Giga Texas. Before we move on, let's tie up some loose ends. First, water vapor is produced in several of the process steps, which could be condensed and recycled back into the process for leaching and/or amination. Second, my understanding is that some of the reaction processes are exothermic, namely the reactions that occur in the carbonating tower and processing the leach solution with lime. If that's the case, some of the heat from those exothermic reactions could be captured and used in other process steps to save energy. Third, the patent application indicates the process is feedstock flexible and able to use several lithium-containing minerals as inputs. My understanding is that lithium refineries are typically optimized for a single type of input material, which may make Tesla's refinery more robust to supply chain disruptions. And Tesla's press release for the refinery went a step further, saying that in the future, they expect the facility to process recycled batteries and manufacturing scrap. However, I expect that would require additional equipment. With all that in mind, what are the odds that this process is what's being used at Tesla's lithium refinery near Corpus Christi, Texas? For the refining side, it's all but confirmed, and for the on-site soda ash production, it's unclear. Let's take a look at the evidence. First, Turner Caldwell of Tesla stated that instead of using a sulfuric acid-based process, Tesla would be using a soda ash or sodium carbonate-based process along with lime, and that the waste products would be sand and limestone. That matches what I found in the patent application. Second, as Howard Klein of RK Equity indicates here, Tesla has supply agreements for spodumene from Quebec, which is the mineral that the patent application focuses on. Third, it was reported by several reputable sources that Tesla's refining process will use 35% less natural gas compared to traditional processes. My understanding is that the source of that information was an impact report, but I wasn't able to locate the wording. If the information is correct, Tesla may have abandoned plans for the 100% electric refining facility they mentioned at Battery Day, because an electric kiln wouldn't provide the CO2 waste gas necessary to produce soda ash on site. Such a change of plans could help explain why it took so long to get the facility up and running, a full 5 years after Battery Day. And given that the patent application was filed in May of 2025, it's possible that the application was a post hoc way of shoring up the IP around the refinery after they'd mostly completed it. On that note, the written opinion of the International Search Authority for Patents indicated that the inventions claimed in the patent application contained no inventive step. That's because those inventions have already showed up in applications by Otatech and Enpro. So, if Tesla is using the processes claimed in their patent application at their lithium refinery, they may need to reword and/or reattempt their application to secure a patent grant, or ensure they've licensed any inventions used in their lithium refining process from the rightful IP owners, which is common. In summary, the patent application I covered today gives us the best look yet at what's likely Tesla's soda ash lithium refining process, which may or may not include a fully integrated soda ash production plant using a Solvay-type process. The Solvay process is around 160 years old, so it wouldn't require any technological leaps. Rather, the decision to include it would be a cost-benefit decision. Running a gas kiln is typically cheaper than running an electric kiln, and with the ability to capture the CO2 to manufacture soda ash, it would be cheaper still and likely have lower CO2 emissions than a fully electric process. However, fully integrated soda ash production would require more time and greater engineering effort, and create unnecessary risk for Tesla's first lithium refinery. That is, it could be something Tesla instead chooses to implement in a future lithium refinery. Either way, when Tesla's current lithium refinery hits full production, it will make Tesla's 4680 battery supply chain the only end-to-end alternative to the Chinese monopoly, and further increase Tesla's EV cost advantage in the U.S. market. So, if China takes punitive actions towards Tesla, or Chinese companies start building vehicles in the U.S. market, Tesla is prepared to compete. As always, please consider supporting the channel with the links in the description, which now also includes a referral link for Signature Solar. If you use that link to purchase home battery or solar equipment, it nets me a small percent-based credit, but that can add up on a large purchase, and it really helps the channel. On that note, a special thanks to my YouTube members, ex-subscribers, and all the other patrons listed in the credits. I appreciate all of your support, and thanks for tuning in.